Hi, I'm Jo, and I've got plastic in my blood, and I think most of you do too. Today, there are just 30 people in the world who've had their blood tested for plastic pieces, and I'm one of them. Alongside my white and my red blood cells, they found pieces of plastic, the same types of plastic that's used to wrap my veggies, bottled water, takeaway coffee. Obviously, I don't use any of those. Let me give you a little history here. So, I went to school in Blackpool in the north of England, and as a kid, I was pretty ill. I had an autoimmune disease. Didn't know what caused it. But I couldn't run and jump around like other kids, and then my dad introduced me to sailing. On a boat, I was free. I could go anywhere. By the age of 17, I was a skipper. By the age of 20, I was crossing the Atlantic. And then I saw bigger and bigger challenges. So I set sail to the Antarctic. 5 weeks into the voyage, and we hit the Southern Ocean. It's like living in a washing machine, soaking wet, bracing ourselves for the next huge wave to come and wipe us out. We had to do iceberg watch on the bow, which was just painfully cold. 6 weeks later, we got to get off that boat and land on an Antarctic beach. The scenery was just spectacular. And guess what we saw? Oh, come on, guys. You know why I'm here. Plastic. But at that time, seeing a piece of plastic on a beach that was over 1,000 miles away from the nearest town was really a surprise. I worked at sea for 13 years, and year after year visited remote shores, and year after year saw plastic building up on these remote shores, until I became so concerned that I hung up my sailing boots and started to focus my time on stopping plastic getting into the sea. So that led me to find common seas. Fast track to today, and it's hard to imagine feeling surprised to see a piece of plastic on a beach. In fact, despite our best efforts, we've not been able to shout loud enough on behalf of our voiceless ocean. And today, we're finding plastic in nature's most deepest, darkest, precious parts. So as you and I are a part of nature, became curious to understand whether we'd find plastic deep inside our precious parts. So we commissioned the VU in Amsterdam to develop a methodology to wild fish for plastic particles in human blood. Ben and I came over from the UK to Amsterdam, and we had our blood sampled in a plastic-free controlled laboratory, and we waited. And a few months later, we learned that we do have plastic in our blood. With this knowledge, we've got to act quickly, because we can't allow plastic to build up in our bodies, our kids' bodies, in the same way as we've allowed plastic to build up in our marine environment. When I tell people it's likely that they've got plastic in the blood, they often ask me the same two questions. So as I've told you, you might have plastic in your blood. I'll answer these two questions for you. So what? And how come? So, we know that plastic's making Mother Nature sick in all sorts of upsetting and unpredictable ways. But what about us? What about our health? Well, there's three kind of categories of scientific concern, which you'll hear from the experts later. But I'll just introduce them. The first one is particle presence. So, the scientists tell us that our bodies can't break down these persistent pieces of plastic in and that this can lead to autoimmune disease, like the disease I suffered from a kid, like diabetes, cardiovascular respiratory disease. Just think about this. It only takes one particle of asbestos to lodge in your lung and cause a cancer. And we just don't know about plastics. The second area is chemical toxicity. There are 144 chemicals known to be hazardous used in plastic packaging. So are we wrapping our kids' lunches in a packaging that contains hazardous chemicals? Scientists mimicked the digestive tract of mammals, and under that warm, juicy, humid environment, they learnt that the chemicals are releasing 30 times faster. The third area is vector transfer. So bacteria builds a living biofilm on plastic, and this bacteria could contain harmful pathogens. So as we breathe in or drink these plastic particles, is harmful bacteria hitching a lift inside our bodies and making us poorly? At the end of the day, every time I learn something new about plastic and health, it's bad news. So this brings me on to the second question that I get asked when I say you might have plastic in your blood. And this is how come? How come plastic's hitching a lift in our arteries? And this one is pretty easy to answer. In 1950, we had just 2 million tons of plastic made. In 2019, there were 370 million tons of plastic made. And this keeps increasing, increasing, and increasing. So, plastic is just everywhere. Our beautiful, life-giving mothership that we call Earth is so overrun with plastic that it's in our food, our water, our air. So is it any surprise they found plastic in my blood, in the blood that's bathing my heart, my liver, my brain? I used to think of plastic as an issue that's kind of over there in the sea, that poor turtle with a straw up its nose that haunted us all. But actually, I've come to realize that humans are the most exposed species. Our lives are so wrapped in plastic, I can't think of another species that has more plastic around their everyday lives, maybe aside from a critter living in a landfill. To reduce our exposure to plastic, we need to reduce the amount of plastic in our world, in our lives. So it's pretty terrifying to realize that we're heading in completely the wrong direction. It was 20 years ago since I stood on that beach with Magnus, surprised to see a piece of plastic, and that feels fairly recently. In the next 20 years, plastic production is on track to double. $2.3 trillion is forecasted to be invested in new plastic production in the next 20 years. And this is disastrous for our environment, it's disastrous for us. As our exposure to plastic skyrockets, is the risk to our health also increasing? I think it's likely, but I know we have the right to know for sure. There is zero correlation in the relationship between the investment into new plastic production and to that into investment into understanding what that plastic production is going to do to our health. Like many of you here, and we're going to learn all about today, Common Seas is doing what we can to advance scientific understanding. We've partnered with the VU Amsterdam for the blood type plastic research. With Imperial University London, we have over 200 tissue samples from the intestine and the brain, and we're looking to see if plastic accumulation is linked with ill health. We're looking to see whether plastic particles increase in our bodies when we have a meal that's wrapped in plastic packaging. In partnership with Deltares University and my colleagues in Indonesia, they're fishing out dirty diapers from the Brantas River, and they're seeing if these diapers are nurturing pathogens, bacteria that is related to disease affecting children in that region. But you know what? We're all just scratching the surface here. And we all need to call on governments and philanthropists to really meaningfully finance this urgent research. In June this year, 80 NGOs, scientists, and MPs made a call to the UK government to establish a £15 million Plastic Health Impact Fund. And I'd welcome any support you can give to get this fund announced in the Chancellor's budget, which is coming up, the autumn budget, on the 27th of October. But at the end of the day, plastic production and our exposure to plastic is just increasing at such a rate, I don't think we've got time to wait for a complete body of scientific evidence before we start reducing production. And actually, we know that science alone won't cut it. And we know this because we've known about the science for climate change for 70 years, and look at where we are today. And in fact, we're up against the same industry bullies. As the world slowly weans itself off fossil fuels, about 20 years too late, the oil companies, they're not downing tools, but they're building plastic factories and marketing campaigns. And those marketing campaigns are going to tell us we can't know for sure how bad plastic is for our health. Just like we didn't know for sure that burning fossil fuels is going to heat our environment and destabilize our climate. So it's not how big your scientific consensus is, it's what you do with it that counts. And that's why we need to call on the world's most fantastic and committed marketeers, storytellers, and campaigners to take on those merchants of doubt, to take on those incredibly resourced marketing machines, and win. So what does winning look like? What do we need to do to reduce our exposure to plastic? Well, we need governments to step up and protect us, their citizens. We need governments to set targets and report on reduction. We need governments to mandate policies that prioritize the reduction in production, and policies that commit businesses to be responsible for the full life of the material they put on the market. Because at the end of the day, the polluter must pay. We need plastic producers to scale down their output of single-use plastic rather than scaling up production and investment into recycling technologies. There's just 20 plastic producers, 20 companies are responsible for over 50% of the world's single-use plastic waste. And we need businesses to provide us the products that are zero waste, that are part of the circular economy. And we need to act as citizens, not just as consumers. And we need to be committed at the ballot box, in the shops, and in our lives' work. Yes, we need the science, because we have a right to understand how harmful plastic is for our health. But the bottom line is, I don't want plastic in my blood. I don't think you do. And we know how to reduce our exposure today. So let's get on with it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joan.